Radio.
This is Pet Life Radio. Let's talk pets.
Rappaport to the rescue with award-winning animal advocate Jill Rappaport.
Welcome to Rappaport to the Rescue. I'm Jill Rappaport. All right, folks, get your cowboy hats and scootin' boots on for my guest today, country crooner Alex Hall. Now, Hall has opened for Little Big Town, and last year with the legendary Tanya Tucker. He's performed repeatedly at my favorite place in the world, the iconic Grand Ole Opry in Nashville, and he's collaborated on songs with the likes of Vince Gill, Brad Paisley, and recent Grammy winner Brandi Clark. His debut album, Side Effects of the Heart, is out now, and I have to tell you, it is awesome. And just like me, Alex is an animal lover, especially when it comes to horses, having grown up with them his whole life. And his new album even includes the amazing song called Women and Horses. Take a listen.
Big skies and sunsets ain't meant to be broken. That kind of beauty.
When we come back, you will hear from the star himself, Alex Hall.
Take a bite out of your competition. Advertise your business with an ad in Pet Life Radio podcasts and radio shows. There is no other pet-related media that is as large and reaches more pet parents and pet lovers than Pet Life Radio. With over 7 million monthly listeners, Pet Life Radio podcasts are available on all major podcast platforms. And our live radio stream goes out to over 250 million subscribers on iHeartRadio, Odyssey, TuneIn, and other streaming apps. For more information on how you can advertise on the number one pet podcast and radio network, visit PetLifeRadio.com/advertise today.
Let's talk pets.
Let's talk pets
on Pet Life Radio.
Pet Life Radio.
PetLifeRadio.com.
Welcome back to Rappaport to the Rescue. I'm Jill Rappaport, still enjoying and living in the moment of that amazing song, Women and Horses, performed by Alex Hall. Alex, so nice to have you on the show.
Thank you so much. It's nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
And I know people can't see us. I am wearing a cowboy hat, not only an homage to you, but because I'm having a really bad hair day.
Me and you both. Mine's not a cowboy hat, but yours looks good. I just got off an airplane and literally just pulled into my driveway. So I'm right there with you. You're looking great.
Let me talk about that song, Women and Horses. You can't break them. Ain't that the truth, huh?
Amen to that. No kidding. No kidding.
Tell me what inspired you to write that incredible song.
Well, one, thank you very much. And I grew up on a small horse farm in North Georgia, and I grew up rodeoing and barrel racing the majority of my childhood, really from the time that I could walk all the way up until I was about 14 or 15. And that's when I started playing in bars and started pursuing my country music career, you know. So I grew up around horses, grew up with that, but I also grew up with two really strong-willed women in my life, which was my mom and my sister as well. And two grandmothers that are just as fiery as well, that are still there too. So I grew up with them my whole life. And that's really, you know, my dad was a small business owner and was working all the time. So we just grew up on the farm riding horses and stuff. And so that's really how I grew up. And so when I started thinking about this record and really how I kind of became who I am as a, you know, almost a 30-year-old man now at this point and everything else. And I'm married now to another strong, very fiery, independent woman. You know, I really do believe that between all of those women and many others, but specifically those, and then also the horses that were a huge impact on raising me in their own way too, because I had to get up and feed them every morning before school. Even when I was in elementary school, I had to get up before school and go do that and learn how to ride them and take care of them. And they equally take care of you and all of the above. And so I just thought a lot about that. And I was writing with Brandi Clark for the very first time we actually had ever written together. And
wow, what an incredible artist.
No kidding. She's amazing. And she's featured singing on the song with me as well. And she ironically came in with that title of Women and Horses. She was reading a book and she's not really a horse person at all, which is hilarious.
But she's fiery. So she could relate.
She is. She is. And she didn't know that I grew up with horses either. And so it was this weird serendipitous moment of like, she had this idea that was perfect for what I was wanting to write that day and kind of all came together. And so out came Women and Horses. And that's a very long explanation, but that's really what the song is about. I wrote it for those women and the horses that helped shape me into who I am today.
And I can so relate to it. Every verse really hit home with me. And I know animals have had such a huge impact on your life, obviously, especially horses. And now you're part of this amazing campaign, Seen Through Horses, how they really touched you and changed your life.
Absolutely. I mean, again, I don't think I realized it until I was a little bit older, but down to the work ethic of continuing to try to pursue my dream of music, which is one of the greatest things in the world, but also one of the hardest things to achieve in the world as well. I think the work ethic of, you know, again, having to take care of those horses and as a kid, keep an animal alive that weighs 1,500 pounds, but also the therapeutic aspect of getting on the back of a horse and just going to ride and get away from everything as well, which I also learned at a very young age. So, I mean, I think horses, again, did very specifically, I think, impact my life a lot. But I mean, we have two dogs. I've always had animals and chickens and goats and all of the above. And I just think animals in general are the best form of, I don't know, camaraderie that you can have. I would pick an animal over a person probably any day of the week.
I can't believe you said that. I used to always say that to my mother and she would say, you shouldn't say that. And I go, that's how I feel.
I think people who say you shouldn't say that don't get it. You know, I just don't think they quite understand. They might have better friends than we do or something. I don't know, but I'm picking my dogs or a horse or something over most people, I think.
And also now with the plight going on in rescue and adoption, it's so dire and people need to understand, Alex, from you, who's still in his 20s and is a role model for our next generation. We need to take care of our fur angels, don't we?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I just got back from Raleigh, North Carolina, and I was singing the national anthem at their hockey game at PNC Arena there. We were in there early doing sound check and stuff, and they do this every week, which I thought was so cool. They have specifically, I think it's dogs. Every once in a while they have cats, but they had this company out of Raleigh that does animal rescue and fostering and adoption, and they have them in the arena for the games every week for folks to come by and see them. The puppies weren't ready for another couple of weeks, but they're there to like meet them, hang out with them, and show awareness of it. And I thought that was the coolest thing because there are 19,000 people in this arena.
Right, to shine a light on a big crowd like
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely. And so we went up there, I think, three different times to go hang out with the dogs and stuff before the game even started. But I thought that was just a really great thing because it is important. And I know there's a lot of missions and folks out there all around the country now that are doing that kind of stuff. It blows my mind.
I'm surprised you didn't come home with one.
My radio rep and I both tried our best to. She wanted one real bad and she doesn't have a dog at the moment. But I think my wife would have been too happy with me if I came home with a puppy. But maybe next time.
Well, what a year this has been for you. 2023 into 2024, you came out with your album, which is so incredible, getting great reviews and is so awesome. I did say that right in the top of the show. Tell me about the experience of coming out with this album. You opened for Tanya Tucker, a true legend. What is your world like at such a young age?
Well, thank you again for all that. I've been able to tour Tanya a good amount through the last couple of years, and that alone is just amazing because I grew up listening to her, which is so cool. And I got to meet Chris Christopherson out on tour with her the first time I toured with her and got to just do so many cool things with that. But as far as putting the record and everything out last year, it was just really, I feel like something that was like finally happened because, you know, that record really began in 2019. I started recording and writing for that album, and then the pandemic came along and started shifting things and changing things. And we pivoted. And finally, it got finished. Speaking of furry friends.
Yeah, we love barking on this show.
There could be a better podcast to have barks on, I guess. But it finally came out, last year. And so it was almost 4.5 years in the making of writing and recording that record. And so it just was honestly, I feel like a breath of fresh air to finally put it out into the world. And I've been playing a lot of the songs, like Women and Horses specifically. I've been touring for a couple of years. I'd written that song in 2020. So I've been playing a couple of the songs for the years, but it's just nice that they're out. So like when you're going to play a show or whatever it is, people can actually go listen to the songs that you're playing versus telling them they're coming soon and you don't know when that's going to be. So I think out of all of it, that's the greatest thing. It's just that it's out and I can, you know, move on to writing new music and recording new music, which I'm doing at the moment. And it's exciting. I'm happy that it's out into the world and hopefully people love it and will continue to find it and love it throughout the rest of my life and however long music lasts, I guess.
And you also performed at my dream place. Every time I went to the Grand Ole Opry, it was the experience of a lifetime. You got to perform there. I want to know what it was like to stand in the circle.
Oh my goodness. I think I've done it 6 or 7 times now and it never gets old. I was talking to Vince Gill once backstage about it, and I was asking him because he's been a member for decades and he plays it multiple times a year. And he told me to this day, he's like, if it ever doesn't get you nervous, then you just don't need to play anymore. Like, you just don't need to do it anymore because it's like, it's supposed to feel sacred and feel special every time. And it does. It's my favorite place to play. I haven't been able to play the Ryman yet, and that one's still on my bucket list, which is obviously, the original Opry and everything. But I don't know, there's just something special about it. And almost, I think, every single hero of mine has at some point stood in that circle. And so that is the thing to me that's just so powerful, is the sweat and the passion and years of just people that I've looked up to have my sweat and tears and everything are in that circle now too. And that's pretty cool.
You know, I can't even imagine, because here you are in your 20s and you've achieved this level of success. How old were you when you actually got started, when you realized you had to have a guitar on your lap and you had to sing those songs?
I got my first guitar when I was 5. I was 5 or 6, and I took one lesson. It didn't work out very well. And the guy said he couldn't teach me because I didn't know how to read, which is hilarious. So I put the guitar away for many years, and I started really, really getting into it when I was about 14 or 15 years old. And that's when I got my first gig getting paid to play a show, which was, even though it was in a restaurant, I still was getting paid to play. And then I started making trips back and forth to Nashville to write songs and stuff. But it was about 15 years old when it really was like, I got my first paid gig, started playing shows, started coming to Nashville to write songs with other songwriters and all of that. And that was the point, I think, for me, that it was that first trip to Nashville and my very first co-write. Seeing the city and walking through the Country Music Hall of Fame and all of that on that first trip, is, I think there was just no turning back at that point. I always knew I wanted to grow up to be Elvis Presley. That was my dream. My whole life was to be Elvis or Lane Frost, the bull rider, who was also, unfortunately, he died at riding bulls. But those were the two things as a kid from North Georgia that I wanted to be, was either that or Elvis. And so I think, I clearly went the music route, thankfully. But
thank God you took the safer route. I will tell you.
No kidding. No kidding. Yeah, no, I never had much of a thing for bulls. So yeah, it was the guitar for me. It was the guitar for me for sure.
And when you consider that you've opened for Tanya Tucker, I mean, does it get bigger than that? And you've worked with Vince Gill, Brad Paisley, Some of the biggest and best in the country world. What did they teach you? How did they inspire you?
I mean, I think, Tanya, for instance, just touring with her, being able to watch her, especially the tour we did in 2019, where her record came out that year and won the Grammy for Country Album of the Year and all that. I got to watch her every night on that tour and just hold the crowd in the palm of her hand all night long. She's a pro. And so that, I think, was just really priceless to be able to watch. But as far as working with Vince and Brad Paisley and those folks, one, I just still can't believe that even happened, because I grew up listening to them. It's crazy to have their thumbprint on my record, especially, I mean, I'm still, again, trying to make it. But at that time, we were on lockdown in COVID, and I really hadn't done a whole lot at that point. And so for them to say yes is incredible. But I've said this before, but I think to me, the thing that I learned out of all of it, besides their guitar parts that I've continuously tried to learn off of those records, is just lending your time and generosity to other artists that are up and coming that, you're able to put your thumbprint on and help them up and continue to carry the torch of what we're all trying to do and make country music and keep it relevant and make great music. And I think the fact that somebody like Vince or Brad Paisley is willing at their level to say yes to me at my level to play and put their name on a song is just amazing. So I feel like I have to keep up the good work, so they don't regret it down the road. And also remember, once I'm at their level, to do the same thing,
I love how you say, once you're at their level, that's the way to feel. That's the way to think, because you're definitely on your way if you're not. What's amazing to me is that there's so much camaraderie and closeness and friendship in the country world. A lot of businesses, and sometimes in this world, people are competitive and they don't always help one another. But it seems in the country world, everybody really seems to have your back.
I think so. I mean, I think it would be silly to say that there's not competitiveness still, because I think, everybody wants to win. Like, nobody's going to say they don't want to win Entertainer of the Year or, CMA Male Vocalist. You want to win. If you don't win, that's okay. But I think that the thing is, for sure, like you said, is like the fact that I do feel like most of the people are cheering you on regardless, even if you're nominated in some category. It doesn't mean you don't want to win. But you're still able to clap for your friends, I think. And that is definitely a beautiful thing that I don't think a lot of other genres have that country music does, for sure. And it's awesome.
You have such a beautiful voice. Your songs are really, they resonate with the heart. What is it, do you feel, is distinctive about your style?
I don't know that I've ever been asked that question before. I don't know. I sing with my heart. I don't think about it too much, to be honest with you. I definitely think about what goes into the songwriting, and I try to be honest in that aspect of it and stuff. But when it comes to singing and playing guitar, I truly try my best to take my brain out of it and just let my heart do the leading on it. And I just sing what I'm feeling and play what I'm feeling. And that's how it comes out. I don't know. I was blessed with that gift. I can't play sports very well. And I, you know, I don't think I'd do very well with a normal 9-to-5 job either. So I was just blessed with the gift of music, I guess. And I just try to follow my heart when it comes to singing and playing guitar. That's definitely how I try to do it.
Well, like I said, this has been one heck of a year for you. What else is on your very young bucket list?
Well, I have achieved a lot of those bucket list things, but I really want to play the rhyme, and that's definitely up there on the list for me. I'm working on new music this year, recording some new music this year, and I'm going out on tour with my friend Cassie Ashton in a few weeks. We're going to be touring through the rest of the summer, which is awesome. And yeah, just really working on new music, you know, trying to enjoy. I got a 2.5-year-old son, and I'm married and all that, so enjoying their time and everything. But just really writing songs, recording music, and going to be touring a lot. That'll really be it. But goal-wise, my goal this year is definitely to hit the Ryman at some point. And if it doesn't happen this year, maybe next year. But that's definitely on my list.
And who's your dream performer that you would like to either open for, sing with?
Man, I would love to go tour with, in country, I would say like Brothers Osborne and Chris Stapleton. Those would be two that I would really love to do. Brothers are friends of mine. I don't really know Stapleton, but I would love to tour with them. I think it'd be fun. And then outside of country, I think it would be really cool to tour with John Mayer. He's a big, big hero and influence of mine, especially guitar-wise. And so I would say outside of country, I'd love to do a tour with John Mayer.
And may I add, one of the funniest people you'll ever meet. I had the pleasure interviewing him a few times, and I could barely get through the interview. He's hysterical.
Oh, that's amazing. That's great to hear. I love to hear that.
And it's so great because you see so many artists now crossing over into different genres of music. Look at Beyonce. What do you think of her country album, right?
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. And that's definitely, I think, the beauty of streaming. You know, I know there's a lot of downsides to it financially for pay for songwriters and all of the above, but it does allow genres to kind of morph and blend. And when CDs were burnt, people were burning CDs, and you were already kind of mixing genres because you could throw what you wanted on a CD or whatever. But I do think it's a beautiful thing because you do get to allow so many other folks to make music that they maybe wouldn't have typically been able to make in another format 10 years ago, you know.
Well, I would be remiss, Alex, having you here. And I heard a little birdie told me that there is a guitar very close to you. Is that true?
Oh, man. It is not true, but I can
Someone
find
told me a lie?
Somebody told you a lie. I'm not kidding. I pulled in my driveway, grabbed my computer, and jumped on here from the airport. I can find one quickly, though.
Go ahead. Take your time. Go grab one.
All right. I'll grab one and be right back.
Okay, folks. Stay tuned. Just wait a minute now.
I have my AirPods. I don't know if it sounds all right.
So, Alex, you're amazing. I put you on the spot. But now that you got the guitar, I got to hear a little of Women and Horses. Would you do it
for me? Alrighty, I got you. Let me get this thing in tune real quick so it actually sounds good. Do you want like a little verse and a chorus? How's that?
Whatever you can do, we'll love.
All right, let's see. Her eyes are the prettiest shade of wild that you've ever seen. Her voice is the sweetest song on a honeysuckle breeze. And her heart is a tumbleweed you're gonna wanna hold. But if you wanna keep her, you gotta let her roll. 'Cause big skies and sunsets ain't meant to be broken. That kind of beauty is meant to be soaked in. Dolphins and her freedom. Leave the gate open, 'cause women and horses ain't meant to be broken.
is amazing. What a
win. Thank you very much.
The show, Alex Hall, I cannot thank you enough. I had my own one-on-one private concert.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you. We started the show with the song, and I have to tell you, hearing it in person, it sounds exactly the same, maybe even better. I caught off guard, but you are amazing. You were an amazing guest. Thank you so much for being on Rappaport to the Rescue.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I really do appreciate it. And you guys are, you know, shining a light on such amazing stuff. I really do appreciate what y'all are doing and for letting me be part of it.
Well, I was thrilled to have you here, and thank you all for tuning in today to Rappaport to the Rescue. You even got a free concert out of it. And just remember, in the end, it's all about taking care of our fur angels. Please opt to adopt.
Let's Talk Pets, every week on demand, only on PetLifeRadio.com.